Good morning. Welcome to the parish community of St. Francis of Assisi. In the presence of the resurrected Christ, let us praise God, singing hymn number 433, Canticle of the Sun, number 433. Please stand.
We continue our celebration in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My friends, may the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Well, today, here at St. Francis, we come together to celebrate, in a very special way, the feast of our patron, St. Francis of Assisi, which was Friday. And yet, with that being our patron, we recognize the importance of this influential person, Francis of Assisi, who sought to live the gospel within his own period of time. We take from his example a way in which we too hopefully are willing to accept the invitation that Jesus extends to each and every one of us to be Christ for our world. At the same time, we are fortunate to welcome the Sisters of Life who are going to be speaking to us and sharing with us about their ministry and the various things that they are engaged in. So we welcome them. And we welcome all of you who are maybe here at St. Francis for the first time. And we are honored that you have chosen to worship with us. And yet, as a family of faith, we recognize our own human tendencies to turn from God and the ways of the gospel. We take a moment and we ask for God's mercy and for the Spirit to enlighten us in mind and heart to begin again. And so we pray. Lord Jesus, you are the good shepherd who goes after the lost sheep. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you are the light that helped the blind to see. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the Word made flesh that helped the deaf to hear. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may Almighty God have mercy on all of us, forgive all of our sins, and bring us all to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, by whose gift St. Francis was conformed to Christ through his example of poverty and humility, grant that by walking in the footsteps of Francis of Assisi, we may seek to follow your Son with perfect charity and united in his love to proclaim the works of your kingdom here on earth. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Sirach. Behold him in whose times the house of God was renovated, in whose days the temple was reinforced. In his time, the reservoir was dug, the pool with a vastness like the seas. He protected his people against brigands and strengthened his city against the enemy. Like a star shining among the clouds, like the full moon at the holy day season, like the sun shining upon the temple, like the rainbow appearing in the cloudy sky. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm response is number 773. Number 773.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord. Let us taste the goodness of the Lord. Of the Lord, let us taste the goodness of
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Galatians. Brothers and sisters, may I never boast of anything but the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Through it, the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. It means nothing whether one is circumcised or not. All that matters is that one is created anew. Peace and mercy on all who follow this rule of life and on the Israel of God. Henceforth, let no man trouble me, for I bear the brand marks of Jesus in my body. Brothers and sisters, may the favor of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. The word of the Lord.
My friends, the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. On one occasion, Jesus spoke thus, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, to you I offer praise, for what you have hidden from the learned and the clever, you have revealed to the merest of children. Father, it is true. You have graciously willed it so. Everything has been given over to me by my Father. No one knows the Son but the Father, and anyone to whom the Son wishes to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are weary and who find life burdensome. I will refresh you. Take my yoke upon your shoulders and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble of heart. Your soul will find rest, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The Gospel of the Lord. Again, a very special welcome to everyone gathered here, and of course the Sisters of Life, who are going to be speaking to us after communion about their special ministry. Today, here at St. Francis, unlike the other churches in the diocese, we are celebrating the feast of our patron, and so our readings are different from the rest. And our patron, Francis of Assisi, is an interesting character. Within the context of the church, he is probably identified as one of the more popular, well-known saints, not just by Catholics, but non-Catholics alike. And of course, we always ask ourselves, what was it about this poor man from Assisi, who initially started his life out, following the pursuits of many of his companions, of wine, women, and song, enjoying a good time, eventually chosen to inherit his father's wealth and clothing business, but eventually had a change of heart and mind after serving as a in the military and returning home, recognizing that God was maybe calling him to something else. He was often and is often identified as a bit of a free spirit, a fool for God, labeled in a variety of different ways that usually are quite appealing and attractive and quite interesting, to say the least. And so when we turn the pages back, we look probably some 24 years ago at the change of the millennium. Time magazine, or maybe it was Newsweek, labeled Francis of Assisi as one of the most influential people of the last century. Why? And then we have someone like Pope Francis, who in his installation as one of the first Jesuit popes, chose the name Francis, not from a Jesuit saint like Francis Xavier, but rather Francis of Assisi. Why? And of course, we look and we see that Francis, with the many different labels that were attached to him and are attached to him, of his attractiveness, his uniqueness, one of the things that often gets forgotten and maybe lost in the equation, he is often identified as the alter Christus, the other Christ. And that throughout the history of the church, when we look at the various people, notably some of the saints, there is none other like Francis of Assisi who came close to seeking to be Christ in the world in which he was a part of. And as we kind of think about that just for a little bit, I look at today's gospel. It is a gospel no doubt Francis heard many, many times. Come to me, all you who are weary, who find life burdensome, and I will refresh you. I know quite truthfully that for Francis in his own life journey, he found his own life filled with its own darkness and struggles. We remember, of course, that probably one of the most pivotal and important things that led to Francis's own conversion had to do with his time and his experience of going off to battle with the great hopes of salvaging his people in Assisi, of conquering the neighboring town. It was his experience within the context of war and battle that he came to have a taste of death. No doubt he had a taste of his own mortality, and he served as a prisoner of war. And it is often said that Francis probably killed someone during his time in battle, and as a prisoner of war, experienced his own sense of loss, of death, and a true meaning of what life was all about. I think it was his parents that, you know, helped to pay for his release, and upon returning home, was not coming home as a wartime hero, but rather as a loser, a nobody, haunted by his own depression and loss and despair. And returning home in this manner, with dreams unfulfilled, experiencing a taste of darkness, I don't doubt for a second that his hope was quite limited as to what was to come. And yet, hearing the ringing of a bell, alerting him that he was in close proximity to a dirty, smelly leper, those people that had that skin disease that was contagious, that marginalized them and put them off to the other side, Francis ordinarily admits he would have looked away, probably taken another path. But something happened. Something pushed him and called him to get off that horse and to embrace this dirty, smelly leper that was right before him. And in so doing, he came to experience and see the face of Jesus Christ. This marked the beginning of his own transformation and conversion. And it was here, I believe, that he came to take this experience of the gospel quite literally. It was not only himself who was answering the invitation of coming to Jesus with all of his own burdens and darkness, but he also recognized maybe his own vocation was to reach out to those who were marginalized, living within their own darkness. And it was from there that he began his own journey of becoming the alter Christus, the other Christ. And I often think of my own Franciscan journey, what led me to joining the friars as opposed to the Jesuits, the Dominicans, or maybe being a diocesan priest. And prior to my entry into the friars some 30-some-odd years ago, I will never forget the words of a brother Giles, who was a Franciscan friar, who was speaking to myself and the other people who were going to be part of Covenant House in New York City, and we were working with homeless children. I came from Loudonville. What did I know about homeless children? Quite truthfully, nothing. But we were embarking upon this 13-month program that allowed us to live and to work in community and to work with the homeless children that were served at Covenant House. And I can remember Brother Giles saying to us, above all, you are to try not only to see the face of Christ in the children that you are dealing with, but to also try to be the face of Christ for them. Because you know what? You might be the only gospel they ever hear or experience. That jarred me a little bit. I didn't quite comprehend what he was talking about. But soon as time evolved, and I had my own encounters and experiences with many of the homeless kids that came to our doors, they weren't always welcoming, they weren't always thankful for the services we were providing. In fact, more times than not, they were quite challenging, to say the least. And so this task that Brother Giles had given us, not only to see the face of Christ, but to be the face of Christ, was much more challenging than I had anticipated. It was very much about a dying to self, dying to one's ways and natural inclinations, and taking on something new. I realized this wasn't something that was going to happen overnight, but it was going to be gradual. It was going to be transformative. And in some instances, probably my efforts would be in vain. But I kind of got the gist as time evolved. And it was there, too, that I encountered the friars, blocks down the street around Penn Station. Early in the morning, when I would walk by the church, I would see the large crowds of homeless people who would be served in the bread line. I walked into the church and saw the many services that the friars provided, people with AIDS, various people that struggled with 12-step programs, with different addictions, and there were numerous other ministries that truly reached out to the community within the church and outside the church who were hurting, whose life was burdened by a heavy darkness and challenges that they couldn't take on their own. And I came to see that it was the friars who in many ways were seeking to, you know, follow the true example of Jesus Christ, and very much like Francis of Assisi, as he, again, sought to understand what God was calling him to do and to be, he himself took this gospel that we just heard quite literally, reaching out to those whose life was burdened by its own darkness and ambiguity, reaching out to them and being Christ for them and seeing Christ in them. And so, I think in many ways what attracted me was that great challenge that continues to be day in and day out. Not only to be Christ, but to try to see Christ in the circumstances and the people that I deal with day in and day out. For us, as we celebrate this feast of St. Francis, again, we recognize we have a great example, a great patron to follow. And yet in the hardships and challenges that sit before us day in and day out, true to our own baptism in terms of claiming being identified and in Christ Jesus, that we have been baptized into his life, his death, and resurrection. And hopefully, as a family of faith, we seek to continue to carry out the good news of the gospel, to not only to be the face of Jesus Christ, but to be the face of Jesus Christ, but to also to see Christ in all that we do and the people that we serve. May God's peace and all that is good be with you. Together we stand, and in one voice and one heart, we profess our creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell, and on the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. We now bring our own prayers and our needs and our hopes before the Lord. Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer.
For the gift of gratitude for our lives and the goodness that dwells therein, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the Spirit's gifts needed to support the ministries of the Sisters of Life, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For an end to the death penalty in our country that robs the innocent of life and the guilty of redemption, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the nations to address with compassion the plight of the world's refugees and asylum seekers, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear our prayer. For endurance within the church to walk with people so they need not consider abortion or assisted suicide as options, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For security for all the innocent victims and the hostages of the Israeli-Hamas war, and an end to the senseless suffering and death that war inflicts, above all on women and children, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear our prayer. For the strength and courage for Christians to speak up in the face of racism, anti-Semitism, and hate that degrade human dignity, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For creativity in dealing with the issues of poverty, mental illness, and human trafficking, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For a just wage and living conditions for migrant workers who gather the fruitfulness of the earth for farmers in this harvest season, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For faith and trust to mark the lives of those who grieve, and the eternal life be the hope of our dead in Christ, including Stephanie Herkenham and Thomas McCormick, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For a deepened relationship with God of Israel for the Jewish community as they mark their high holy days, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the people and situations we hold deep in our hearts and bring to this holy table, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, we ask that you continue to pour forth your Spirit upon all of us gathered here. Dispel the darkness of our hearts and of our world. Grant that we may always have a correct faith and a certain hope and a perfect charity as we seek to carry out your holy and true command. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
As we prepare the Lord's table and ourselves to offer the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, let us join in singing hymn number 535, Prayer of St. Francis, number 535.
Make me a channel of your peace. Wherever
Pray, my friends, that this our sacrifice will be acceptable to our good and loving God. Good and gracious God, on this holy day, we ask that you accept the special gifts that we bring to your table, the gifts of bread and wine, and the gifts of our own lives. May they always be acceptable and pleasing to you. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. My friends, the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just that we should always give you thanks and praise, almighty and ever-loving God, for the countless ways through which you seek to reveal yourself to all the world and through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. For though the human race is divided by dissension and discord, we know that you are continuously inviting us to change our hearts that they may come to know healing and reconciliation. Even more, may your spirit move human hearts so that enemies begin to speak to one another, adversaries join hands in friendship, and people seek the way of peace together. By the working of your power and spirit, it comes about, O Lord, when hatred is overcome by love, revenge gives way to forgiveness, and discord is changed to mutual respect. And so we give you endless thanks. We join our voices with the choirs of heaven, and together without end, we acclaim. Lord, you are holy, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending forth your Spirit upon them, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, Jesus took bread into his sacred hand. Giving thanks, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when the supper had ended, he took the chalice. Once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, poured forth for you and for all people, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me." the mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim
as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation. We give you thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and to minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking in the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, Edward, our Bishop, and to all your holy people your Son has gained for you. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on all of us, we pray, that together with Mary, the Blessed Virgin Mother of God, with Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles, the martyrs, St. Francis of Assisi, and all the saints, on whose constant intercession we rely for help, may we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. For it is through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in union with the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. And now together in one voice and one heart, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, my peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. My friends, may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with all of you. Let us now share with one another a sign of Christ's peace. My friends, behold. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold the one who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring us all to everlasting life. I would now like to invite Sister Mary to please come up to the ambo, and she is going to speak to us about her ministry as a sister.
Thank you, Father Sean. I just wanted to share something with you really quick. You're obviously a very pro-life parish, and Father Sean, with his beautiful and humble sharing of his vocation story and the most powerful intercessions here, my work is pretty much already done. So thank you so much, Father Sean. It's beautiful to hear about your missions. First of all, I'd like to tell you about my community. We were founded by John Cardinal O'Connor in 1991, and I was one of the first sisters that came. We professed the usual vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience, and we profess a fourth vow, which is our particular charism, to protect and enhance the sacredness of every single human life. From all of eternity, God desired that you exist. He wanted to make you in his own image and likeness, a unique and unrepeatable reflection of his eternal glory. There is nobody like you, and there never has been, nor will there be. And your worth doesn't come from what you do, or how much money you make, or who your friends are. He loves you simply because you are you. This is the most stunning truth. Every human person, no matter how strong or weak, rich or poor, healthy or sick, is loved and willed. That is why our community exists. We exist so that every person can encounter the goodness of their own life and every person's life. As Sisters of Life, our main work is prayer. We pray 4.5 hours every day, and all of our missions flow from that. Our evangelization team evangelizes on the church's teachings on love and life, speaking in many different states, at pro-life banquets, parishes, etc. We serve pregnant women in our visitation mission in Manhattan, Phoenix, and in Toronto, which is an outreach to women in a crisis pregnancy. And our sisters are very busy in that mission, with so many women coming to us and getting all the aid that they need to give life to their child. We have a huge co-worker mission, lots of volunteers that help us to bring those children to birth. And that's what actually gives life back to their mother. We have a convent in Manhattan, our Holy Respite Mission, where we invite pregnant women to live with us during their pregnancy. Our sisters have the privilege of journeying with them through the ups and downs of pregnancy, and often when they give birth, and are with them when they give birth. They usually stay about 6 to 9 months while they adjust to being a new mother. It is such a beautiful mission, and it's so very, very life-giving. In Yonkers, New York, we have an rapidly growing Hope and Healing Mission, which is an outreach to women that have suffered from the wound of abortion. And our sisters share what a great privilege it is to journey with them, helping them to know God's unfathomable love and mercy, and that they had indeed been forgiven. This summer, I happened to be in the airport. My flight was, I had a long layover. And I was looking for a little place I could kind of hide out and just do my prayers, because you know how busy airports are. And I found one of the places, I forget, number 32, that nobody was in except this one woman. So I said, oh, I'm going to go over there. So I just started my prayers, and all of a sudden she gets up and she looks at me and she goes, "Sister, are you trying to get away from the madding crowd?" I go, "Yes." And she goes, "Me too." And she goes, "I'm Catholic. Sit down and talk with me." And the next 2 hours, we had the most beautiful conversation. She was Catholic. She had 3 children. Her oldest son was in Notre Dame. And then I started sharing. She asked me all about my work. First, she told me about her marketing and everything, and then she asked me about my work. So I told her that all of our missions, how they all had come into being. And I shared with her something our founder had said many years ago that I never forgot in our very early days. He was sharing in one of his conferences. He said, "Sisters, I want you to know, the walls of your convents are going to come falling over from the amount of post-abortive men and women," he said men at that time too, he said, "that are come flying in need of healing." He goes, "I want you to take them in your arms and you tell them that God built a community for them. You welcome them home and let them know of God's great mercy." I never forgot it. I shared this with this woman. And the next thing you know, she was in tears, crying. And she said, "Sister Mary, you know what? I've never been able to forgive myself. I've been to confession so many times." And I go, "Okay, none of that." I said, "This is what you're going to do. You have the means." I said, "You're going to call my sisters in the Hope and Healing Mission." I was giving her newsletters. And I said, "And they are going to get that stop. That is not of God. God is forgiving. His mercy is unconditional." I said, "You're going to go to my sisters at the Hope and Healing Mission, and they're going to get it all set straight, and we're going to kick Satan out once and for all." And we left crying and hugging each other. It was the most beautiful encounter. And this weekend, we got a fax that said they were having a Hope and Healing weekend to please pray, because people were coming from Texas, Arizona, and some other state. And I said, "Oh, please let that be Natalie." And it was just like, just how God like works out these little encounters. So we now have foundations in Phoenix, Denver, and Toronto. But the real place I wanted to talk to you about today is our newest foundation in Catskill. It is just now in the beginning of its fourth year. And it was a tremendous gift of God. We had been praying and discerning about the need for an infirmary for our aging sisters, of which I am becoming, and had begun asking ourselves if we should add to our mother house and build an infirmary. But by the providence of God, and through an interesting set of circumstances, we were invited to start a new foundation in Catskill at the former St. Anthony's Friary. The friar shared with us that he had an infirmary and rooms equipped for handicap access, and it is perfect for our present and future needs. So we are doing in Catskill what Cardinal O'Connor spoke of so much about in the early conferences in the early days of our foundation. He would remind us that the attacks of the culture of death are on the family, and that abortion and euthanasia are direct attacks on the family. So we are living family life, just a slightly bigger family, and everything we do by the very nature of our consecration bears fruit and supports and upholds all of you, the domestic church. We are learning as all families do, in reverencing and being attentive to the needs of one another, what would be most helpful. We're learning about aging, loving, growing in patience, and learning to recognize our own limitations. In Catskill, we weren't really sure of what our secondary missions would be, but since our very beginning, the missions and apostolates have just sort of formed around us. As we find our way and always attentive to the promptings of the Holy Spirit, we have a weekday mass Monday through Saturday at noon, except on Wednesday, and that is always open to the public. We have many seniors come, mothers come, husbands that drop in during work at lunch. We offer priests seeking solitude and prayer with the Lord, a hermitage, with a private oratory where they come for a couple of days. Once a month, we host what is known as the Source, which is an evening holy hour on the last Saturday of the month, a time for prayer and adoration, accompanied by our sisters playing and singing worship songs in the background. We are also blessed to have a couple of priests hearing confessions on those evenings. But what I really wanted to tell you, and what I really just feel so called to share, is that we started having volunteer days and whole families come. It's happened since the beginning. We call for a few college students. The next thing you know, all families come. So Saturday, once a month, we have people from the ages of 5 or 6 years old, as well as those that are 70 and above. We look so forward to those days because it's the culture of life. It's a day of so much joy. It's like the culture of life is surrounding us. And it is you people in the pews and those people that come that are giving us so much hope. They think we are the bearers of hope, but they give us so much hope. They restore us. You guys are all out there on the front lines of the culture of death. We're more protected. We pray a lot. We pray at the abortion clinic. We live family life in all of its stages. We do all these things, but it's you that are out there on the front lines. You give us so much hope. When I listen to all your parish ministries, you guys are a people of life. The very fact that you were at Mass means that you were a people of hope, and that you are prayerful, and that you have faith. They say there's only 30% of Catholics going to church right now, but you guys are the culture of life. And I notice the way you bring them all in, and you encourage everyone. Your priest, it's unbelievable. Like, it's like you're building the culture of life in your parishes, and you're reaching out to others and bringing them in. So in closing, I just want to tell you what the day looks like. It's so funny. The 5 and 6 year olds are running around. They get jobs as well, sometimes gardening, sometimes weeding, and they always are running around telling you, I want to be just like you when I get older. And Tommy, he's an 8-year-old altar boy, tells me he's going to be an army chaplain when he gets older. Trudy tells me all about her homeschooling. And Katie tells me what's going on in the school. The college-age kids bring other young people to help us on many of our projects. Chris is in her 70s and extremely agile. Teaches me all about how to get the really high places and the cobwebs on the ceiling. It's really an amazing day. It is the culture of life. It is a culture full of gratitude and a culture full of hope. They minister to us. So when we come here and we see you in the pews, we know you're out there doing this. You're building the culture of life, and we thank you. And my sisters and I will be on either side to kind of meet with you and talk with you about our missions or any of your needs. And I really just want to share one more thing, because I was reading again this week, and I just think it's really important in this day and age. Because Cardinal O'Connor said the attacks will come at both ends of life, and then we've seen a lot more attacks, especially during COVID. So I want everyone here, young and old alike, to read the letter to the elderly. It was by Pope John Paul, and he wrote that letter to the elderly when he was an elder himself. It is beautiful. I was rereading it this week, and it was speaking to my heart. It was full of culture of life language. And then there's another one that I'd like you as families to read, elderly, whatever. I'd like you to read that too. It is by Bishop Olmsted, the former Bishop of Phoenix. He wrote a beautiful pastoral letter years ago on men, helping men to become who God had created them to be, called Into the Breach. And then in 2016, he wrote an apostolic letter to the parishes and to the families of the Diocese of Phoenix. It is full of culture of life language. It teaches families how to flourish. He's honest. He said, we all have frailties. We have divorces. We have difficulties. People are like not understanding chastity. He explains everything in language that every single person
can absorb, and it is the most beautiful apostolic letter I have ever read. And it gives you kind of a map. This is the map for you. This is the map for you who are out there as families, reaching different ages, taking care of one another, and living the culture of life. And I thank you for allowing us to come. Thank you.
Friends, the Lord be with you. Let's bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord look kindly upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord reach out to you in his gentleness and grant you peace in all that is good. May the blessings of Almighty God be upon all of us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. My friends, our celebration has ended, but our lives continue. Let us go in peace to love God and to serve each other.
Thanks be to God.
Have a great rest of the day. Have a great week ahead. Stay safe and thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Let us go forth singing hymn number 547, All Creatures of Our God and King, number 547.
Right. Thank you. That's the end. life keeps you light on your path.
Yes.